Hello, everyone. I'm Pastor Rick here at Tunnel and Warren Chapel United Methodist Churches outside of Marietta, Ohio. And here we are on March 21st of 2021. It's the fifth Sunday in Lent, and I'm so glad that you could join us here at the cross today. Easter Sunday is just 2 weeks away from today on April 4th, the day that we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ. However, there is no Easter Sunday without Good Friday. There's no resurrection without the crucifixion. And up until next Sunday, we're going to be going back 2,000 years and be getting a fresh perspective on the cross through the eyes of those who were there when Jesus was crucified. 2 weeks ago, we looked at the cross through the eyes of the Roman soldier and discovered that it's only God's grace that can break through a hardened and a cynical heart. And then last week, we looked at the cross through the eyes of Mary Magdalene and discovered that what it takes to be a fully devoted follower of Jesus. And here on this fifth Sunday in Lent, every one of the days that we live, God beckons us to journey to the cross and to follow Jesus wherever he leads. Lent calls us to journey to the place where God covenants with us to receive the new names we are given. Lent calls us to worship together and to tell future generations the good news. Lent calls us to practice justice, to bring God's hope to all people. And Lent calls us to faithful living, to trust the one who gives us life. And Lent calls each of us to take up our cross and to trust the one who bears it with us. Lent calls us to journey with God. So let us worship God who walks with us this and every day.
See how great a flame aspires, kindled by a spark of grace. Jesus' love the nations fires, sets the kingdoms on ablaze. To bring fire on earth he came, kindled in some hearts it is. Oh, that all might catch the flame, all partake the glorious bliss. When he first the work begun, small and feeble was his day. Now the word doth swiftly run, now it wins its widening way. More and more it spreads and grows, ever mighty to prevail. Sin strongholds it now o'erthrows, shakes the trembling gates of hell. Saints of God, your Savior praise, who the door hath opened wide. He hath given the word of grace, Jesus' word is glorified. Jesus mighty to redeem, who alone the work hath wrought. Worthy is the work of him, him who spake a word from naught. Saw ye not the cloud arise, little as a human hand? Now it spreads along the skies, hangs o'er all the thirsty land. Lo, the promise of a shower drops already from above. But the Lord will shortly pour all the Spirit of his love.
Let us pray. God of light, God of shadow, in our time that we're spending together today, and we're doing it virtually, we thank you for that technology, but we ask that you keep us aware of your presence in the darkness. Help us to see meaning in this terrible story about the crucifixion of Jesus Christ, and to keep the fire of hope alive in our hearts. This we pray in the name of Jesus from Nazareth, the one who lived with great passion for your way, the one whose death is near, and and the one who taught his friends to pray, saying, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen and amen. Hey kids, it is great to have you with us this morning, and I'm excited and looking forward to that time when we can be back together face to face. And I brought with me this picture, and it's a picture of my dad and my mom, and it's interesting because I have some similarities with both of them. My dad and I had similar hair color, at least when we were younger, and mine's getting that color that he's got in that picture right there, and he's got similar eye color, and our heights were similar, and I have some of the same the facial features of my mom. And unfortunately, I got this hair loss from my mom's side of the family, too. And I like to do some of the same things as my dad, and I also notice that some of his mannerisms, I can see them in myself. And some of this is because we are related and we share genetic traits. And some of this is that we spent a lot of time together as I was growing up, and even after we had our own I had my own family. Families are very important. They shape us, and we tend to be like someone in our family. Who are you like in your family? Do you and your brothers or sisters like similar things? Or maybe you've got look like your mom and dad, or your aunt or your uncle? Or maybe you'll have similar likes with them? Has anyone ever told you that you are like someone else in your family? Yes, we can be like our family members, and we share likes and dislikes and hair color and words, the words that we use and the way that we say things, all kinds of different ways that we're like our families. So did you ever wonder what Jesus meant when he talks about the fact that God is in him and that Jesus is in us, and we are part of each other? That we share life together? It's really confusing. It's hard to think about, isn't it? Because we really can't explain it well, because we can't physically see God. And when we look at each other, we don't see God, because we don't know what God looks like. We have no idea to be able to judge that. When we look at ourselves in the mirror, whether we look at others out on the street. But just like we share traits with our families, Jesus says that we share traits with him and with God, especially as we spend more time with him in his word, the Bible, and in prayer. And the biggest trait that we share is love. Jesus says this is how everyone will know that you are part of God's family, is by showing love. Just like people may know that you're part of your family that you live with now by how you look or how you act, Jesus says by showing love for every person, then everyone will know that you're part of God's family. And when we all share this love, it connects us like family. Jesus wants us to be in God's family, and he promises to be with us always. So what are the ways that Jesus showed love? Yeah, he died on the cross for us and for the whole world, yeah. He healed the sick. He raised the dead, yeah. He loved other people, yeah. What are ways that we can show love? That's right, doing good things for others and being nice to everybody. These are great ways to show God's love and to include everyone in the family of God. Let's pray. Dear Jesus, thank you. Thank you for being with us always. Thank you for showing us how to be like God and how to love everyone. Thank you for making us one big family in your love. Amen and amen. And since you probably, kids, aren't watching this alone, you're there with your families, I want to encourage you to turn to each of your family members and whoever else is there with you in your household and make the sign of the cross and say, Jesus loves you and so do I. See you next week, kids. During Lent, it's appropriate to imagine prayer as being cross-shaped and relational. The vertical line signifies our relationship with God. And prayer is a time to build that relationship. In the midst of that relationship, prayer is a time when God can do his transforming work in our lives. But only if we allow time for God to speak to us instead of monopolizing the conversation. And as we yield to his will instead of insisting on our own way, he can do that mighty work in us. So let us open ourselves to God, yielding to him as we practice listening to God during this Lenten period. And then the horizontal bar, it represents our relationship with others. Prayer is a time that we can intercede for our family, our friends, and even our enemies. We can lift one another and our needs up to God and also praise and thank God for answered prayers and blessings, not just for ourselves, but for others also. And if you have a need to be lifted up or a praise to share, you can call me or text me at 740-304-5133. Again, that's 740-304-5133. Or you can email me at PastorRick@TunnelUMC.org. Again, that's PastorRick@TunnelUMC.org. And if you request it, I'll share it with our prayer warriors, and they will pray with you also. Otherwise, I'll keep it between you and me and God and whomever else you share it with. Jesus willingly submitted to suffer in our place. So let us pray to God our Father and place in his hands the suffering of the world. During this time of prayer, there will be a period of silence for your prayers after each petition, which I'll conclude with, "This is our prayer." And you'll respond praying, "Have mercy on your people, Lord." Let us pray. We pray for the church, for Tunnel and Warren Chapel United Methodist Church, but also for all churches, that we all, as Christians, as followers of Christ, may bear our cross and follow Jesus. This is our prayer. Have mercy on your people, Lord. We pray for those who have sinned, like Peter. Teach us to be sorry for our sins and forgive us for Jesus' sake. This is our prayer. Have mercy on your people, Lord. We pray for the prisoners and criminals like Barabbas. May they find true freedom by changing the way they live and turning to your love and to your grace. This is our prayer. Have mercy on your people, Lord. We pray for people in leadership and government, like Pilate. We pray that you might give them wisdom and that they may be responsible and serve truth and justice. This is our prayer. Have mercy on your people, Lord. We pray for those who are dying, like the thieves who died with Jesus. May they die with Jesus by their side and be received into your kingdom. This is our prayer. Have mercy on your people, Lord. We pray for parents like Mary, who've lost a child. May they bear their suffering and know the comfort of your love. This is our prayer. Have mercy on your people, Lord. We pray for the whole human race, that we all may come to know Jesus as our Lord and Savior and experience his mercy and his grace and his love and his joy and his peace. This is our prayer. Have mercy on your people, Lord. Father, may the suffering and death of Jesus lighten the burdens of all those who suffer, whether physically or mentally or emotionally or spiritually. Lead us in the way of the cross so that as we suffer with Jesus, we may rise to life in His glory, for he lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen and amen.
Of love I owe. Here, Lord. away. 'Tis all that I can do. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. Where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day.
Today, let's look at the cross through the tear-blurred eyes of probably the most distraught person there. Through the eyes of the only person who was there when Jesus took his first breath and when Jesus took his last breath. Through the eyes of Mary, Jesus' heartbroken mother. That's probably not the image that comes to mind when you think of Mary. Usually the first thing that most people think of is Mary at that first Christmas with the animals around and the shepherds and the angels and baby Jesus in the manger. But there's a lot more to Mary's story than just the Christmas story. Mary birthed Jesus when she was just a teenager. When he was crucified at the cross, she was probably in her mid to late 40s. A lot happened in the life between Christmas and the cross. Mary had other children. The Bible tells us that Jesus had four half-brothers and an unknown number of half-sisters. Remember, Joseph wasn't Jesus' biological father. Jesus was conceived by the Holy Spirit. Mary was still a virgin when Jesus was born. And after Jesus' birth, Mary and Joseph had other children. Can you imagine having to grow up with Jesus as your older brother? I mean, talk about a standard to live up to. Hey, why can't you be more like your older brother, Jesus? That would have been difficult. Mary was chosen for this extraordinary task, to be the mother of the Messiah and God with flesh on. But she was also an ordinary woman. That's why it makes it possible for you and I to be able to relate to her. Mary wasn't wealthy. She was engaged to a simple carpenter named Joseph. And like you and me, she had real struggles. She had real doubts, real problems. We don't know exactly when, but at some time before Jesus began his public ministry at the age of 30, Joseph died. Mary at some point became a widow and possibly a single mom. She had real flaws, real fears, and real worries. And the real Mary always points us to Jesus. And even though Mary knew that her son was to be the Son of God, she had no idea what was coming. She had no idea that the baby that she held in her arms in Bethlehem would one day die on a cross in Jerusalem. And she was there, among a handful of people there on that Friday with Jesus as he suffered on that cross for 6 hours. Here's what John says in chapter 19, verses 25 through 27. It says, standing near the cross were Jesus' mother. She's the first one mentioned. And his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. And when Jesus saw his mother standing there beside the disciple that he loved, and since this is the Gospel of John, many believe this was John, he, Jesus, said to her, "Dear woman, here's your son." And he said to this disciple, "Here is your mother." And from then on, this disciple took her into his home. Yeah, and in Mary's experience at that cross, you and I can discover what it really means to be a faithful follower of Jesus. Mary had to make a really incredible, difficult decision, a decision that no one else before, during, or after had to make. She had to decide whether she was going to be Jesus' mother or she was going to be Jesus' follower. Was she going to hold on to Jesus as her son, or was she going to see Jesus as the Son of God, her Lord? Some of you hearing this believe in Jesus. You're a Christian, but if you were honest, you're really not following Jesus. He's not really the Lord of your life. He's not the one calling the shots when it comes to your career or to your relationships or what ever other area of your life we're talking about. You're following someone, but you're following someone or something else other than God. It's led you to the place that you are today, to a place far away from God and away from God's best for you and for your life. Or maybe you're not yet a Christian. Maybe you're not sure exactly what it means to follow Jesus, to say, "Okay, God, I want you to call the shots. I want you to be Lord of my life." So let's learn from Mary what it really means to follow Jesus. And as we learn today, it's important for us to remember that Mary was just an ordinary woman that God chose to use in an extraordinary way. And you know, that's the great thing about God, is that he's always using ordinary people to do extraordinary things. In fact, he only uses ordinary people. But here's the key. We have to follow him for him to use us in that way. We have to follow him for him to use us in that way. So what can we learn from Mary about following Jesus? First, following Jesus begins with obedience. Following Jesus begins with obedience. Just saying you're a Christian doesn't make you a follower of Jesus. I've known plenty of people who say, "I'm a Christian," but you can't tell it by the way that they live their life and that they're really following Jesus. Being born into a Christian family, going to church, reading the Bible, being a good person, those things don't make you a follower of Jesus. The number one characteristic of a follower of Jesus is obedience. It's saying, "Jesus is my Lord, and I'm going to do what he tells me to do." And that's what we see in Mary's life. See, she's a young teenage girl. She's engaged to be married. And then she finds out from the angel that she's pregnant, and not by her fiancé, but by the Holy Spirit. And she's got to explain it to her parents. She's got to explain it to Joseph. This is scary. This is shameful. They could stone her to death for getting pregnant out of wedlock. How would you have responded? And Mary responded with obedience. Luke 1:38 says, "Mary responded, 'I am the Lord's servant. May everything you have said about me come true.'" Mary basically says, "Okay, God, whatever you say, I'm going to do it. I trust you. I'm going to obey." So to be fair, when she spoke those words, she didn't know that her obedience was going to lead to her to the foot of the cross. But at every step in her life, Mary trusted God and said, "Okay, God, I'm going to listen to your voice above every other voice. I'm going to follow you above every other person and every other thing." Let me ask you, have you told God, "God, wherever you lead me, whatever you tell me, I'm going to do it. Whatever you tell, wherever you tell me to go, I'm going to go. I'm going to trust your voice above every other voice." And not picking and choosing what parts of the Bible you want to listen to and what parts you don't want to. Not choosing where you're going to follow Jesus. And when you're not going to follow God, but saying, God, I'm going to follow you no matter what you say. It's interesting that Jesus says the primary way that we show that we really love him is not by how many times we go to church, not by how much we pray, but it's by obeying him. Jesus says in John chapter 14, verse 15, and then in verse 21, if you love me, obey my commandments. Those who accept my commandments and obey them are the ones who love me. Mary's obedience showed that she loved Jesus enough to follow him to the cross. What does your obedience say about your love of Jesus? Everyone makes someone or something Lord of their life, whether it's success or fame or your career or another person. Who or what are you following right now? If it's not Jesus, who or what has become Lord of your life? Are you being obedient to Jesus with your entire life? With your spiritual life, with your dating life, with your finances, with your career, with your thought life? You can trust Jesus enough to obey him. Just look at the cross and see how much he loves you and what he's willing to go through for you. And the second thing that we can learn from Mary about following Jesus is following Jesus leads to both joy and sorrow. Following Jesus leads to both joy and sorrow. And this is hard for some of us to accept because we think, if I'm following Jesus, it should always lead to joy. I'm a Christian now. Everything's going to be great. There aren't going to be any more problems. I'm always going to be happy. But what we discover from Mary is that sorrow is every bit as much a part of life as joy. Sometimes following Jesus will lead you to the foot of a cross. Let's go back to just 40 days after Jesus' birth. Joseph and Mary took Jesus to the temple in order to be blessed, and that's what every good Jewish family would do. And we read about that in Luke chapter 2, verses 27 through 28, and then verses 34 and 35. And it says, so when Mary and Joseph came to present the baby Jesus to the Lord as the law required, Simeon was there. Now, Simeon was an old guy. He was a godly man who had been waiting for his entire life to see the Messiah. He took the child in his arms and he praised God. There's the joy. Then Simeon blessed them, and he said to Mary, this child is destined to cause many in Israel to fail, to fall. There's the sorrow. And then he continues, but he will be a joy to many others. He has been sent as a sign from God, but many will oppose him. There's the sorrow. And as a result, the deepest thoughts of many hearts will be revealed. And then this last part was directed specifically to Mary. A sword will pierce your very soul. What an emotional roller coaster. And sometimes that's what it's like to follow Jesus. There's these moments of joy, but there's also these moments of sorrow. Following Jesus is seldom the easy path. Following Jesus is not the path of least resistance, but it's always the path of greatest reward. In John chapter 16, verses 33, Jesus says, here on earth you will have many trials and sorrows, but take heart, because I have overcome the world. Jesus is saying that if we follow him, he will help us overcome. No matter what we're facing right now, Jesus says, I'll help you through those tough times. In both joy and sorrow, it's important to follow Jesus. Third, we learn from Mary that following Jesus is filled with miracle moments. Following Jesus is filled with miracle moments. Now, what is a miracle moment? A miracle moment is an experience that happens in your life that causes you to say, look at what God did. A miracle moment can be something really big, but oftentimes miracle moments can be really small. And that's the exciting thing about following Jesus. If you're willing to keep your eyes open, you're going to see some miracle moments happening around you every day. Can you imagine how many miracle moments that Mary had with Jesus during their lifetime? One of the first small miracle moments that Mary experienced happened when Jesus was 12. Mary and Joseph had just taken their family to Jerusalem for the Passover. They were traveling with hundreds of people from their town. They had their extended family with them. They were headed back home after the festival, and they assumed Jesus was with one of their family members. And then they discovered that he wasn't, and they had left him behind in Jerusalem. And then he went back, and they couldn't find him. And if you're a parent, imagine that panic of having lost your child and not knowing where he was or where she was. They go back to Jerusalem and they look for him. And in Luke 2, beginning verse 46, we're told the rest of the story. 3 days later. Imagine that. They lost him for 3 days. They finally discovered him in the temple. That's the first miracle moment, finding your child after 3 days. But what was he doing? Sitting among the religious leaders, listening to them and asking questions. All who heard him were amazed at his understanding and his answers. His parents didn't know what to think. "Son," his mother said to him, "why have you done this to us? Your father and I have been frantic searching for you everywhere." "Why did you need to search?" he asked. "Didn't you know that I must be in my father's house?" And then the last line. And his mother stored all these things in her heart. This is just one of many miracles that she had with Jesus. But look at what she does. She stored these things in her heart. She held on to it. She didn't just forget it. She didn't put it off to the side. She held on to it tightly. She stored it in her heart. And Jesus wants you to experience miracle moments with him as well. That's why you and I need to keep our eyes open for those miracle moments that happen every day, where God is doing something that only God can do. We don't always recognize them, but they're right in front of us. Anytime someone says yes to Jesus Christ and receives salvation, that's a miracle moment. Or maybe someone is ill and you pray for them and they get better and they're healed. That's a miracle moment. Or maybe there's a family, they're infertile, they've been trying for years to get pregnant and they've been praying for it, and all of a sudden they're able to get pregnant. That's a miracle moment. They happen all the time. An unexpected blessing, a door that was closed, opens. Those miracle moments, you just have to be looking for them. And unlike Mary, when they happen, hang on to them. Store them in your heart. Write them down. Share them with someone else. But don't forget what God did for you, because when times get tough and you're losing hope, those times of sorrow in your life, these miracle moments strengthen your faith. They remind you that God is doing miracles every day. They remind you that you don't have to give up hope. You don't have to give in. Miracle moments give us hope. And all those miracle moments that Mary had stored in her heart allowed her to have hope even when she was standing at the foot of the cross. Can you think some of the miracle moments that you have had happen in your life? When God came through for you? Let those moments give you hope. Remember, no matter what you're facing now, God will come through for you again. He is faithful. He can provide another miracle. And the fourth thing we learn from Mary is following Jesus requires faithfulness on our part. Following Jesus requires faithfulness. It's easy to remain faithful during a miracle moment, but following Jesus means being faithful even when things are messed up, even when life isn't easy, even when we are in the midst of a worldwide pandemic and our world seems to be turned upside down. Mary was faithful. even though she had to walk down a really tough road. Even though she was going to have to see her son be executed, to have nails driven into his wrist and into his feet, and a sword or spear poked in his side, and to see him breathe his last breath. There had to be times when she felt like abandoning God's plan or going her own way. There was a point in time when we see in the New Testament where Mary and Jesus' brothers tried to stop Jesus' ministry. We see that in Mark chapter 3, verse 21, and then it concludes with verse 35. I'm only going to share a few of those verses, but when Jesus' family heard what was happening, Jesus was teaching, he was healing people, and they tried to take him away. "He's out of his mind," they said. Now, remember, this is his family. "Jesus, my older brother, Jesus, my son, he's lost his mind." What's Jesus doing? He's turning the political and the spiritual world upside down. People are getting really mad at him because he's changing everything. Thinking he's out of his mind, his family goes to him. And they stood outside and they sent word for him to come out and talk with them. And there was a crowd sitting around Jesus, and they said, "Your mother and your brothers are outside asking for you." And Jesus replied, "Who is my mother? Who are my brothers?" And then he looked at those around him and said, "These are my brothers and my mother. Anyone who does God's will is my brother, sister, and mother." That had to be hard for Mary to hear. But I think this is where Mary had her come to Jesus moment. She had to figure out whether she was going to hold on to her role as Jesus' mother or was going to become a follower of Jesus. Was she going to try to force her own plan or was she going to follow God's plan? Mary chose to follow Jesus all the way to the cross. And if you're a follower of Jesus, you don't have to pray for your salvation every morning, but every morning you do have to recommit yourself to being a faithful follower of Jesus by saying something like this: "Jesus, I'm going to let you lead in every area of my life today, at work, in my relationships, at school, with my family, in everything I do, and with everyone that I meet today. You take the lead. You show me the way. You call the shots. I commit to being a faithful follower of yours." Now, faithfulness is not perfection. Faithfulness is not perfection. Faithfulness is growth. It's taking steps towards Jesus and becoming more and more like him. Hebrews chapter 3, verse 14 says, "For if we are faithful to the end, trusting God as firmly as when we first believed, we will share in all that belongs to Christ." Mary was faithful to follow Jesus, even to the cross, and because of that faithfulness, she now shares in all that belongs to Christ. I know it can be hard to be a follower of Jesus when you're the only Christian at work, or you're the only Christian at your school, or you're the only follower of Jesus in your family or in your circle of friends. Be faithful. Maybe you feel like giving up on a dream that God has put in your heart. Maybe you feel like giving up on God or walking away from the church. Don't give up. Remember, God is with you. Be faithful. Trust him. Lean into him. That's been a song throughout this pandemic for me. Learning to lean. I'm learning to lean on Jesus. So lean into God. Lean into Jesus. And if you do, he will see you through and he will bless you for being faithful. And here's the final thing that Mary teaches us about following Jesus. We said to follow Jesus, we need to learn from Mary that it requires obedience. There's going to be times of joy and times of sorrow. Following Jesus is full of miracle moments, and it requires faithfulness. And then finally, following Jesus demands complete surrender. Following Jesus demands complete surrender. If I had to sum up in one word what it means to follow Jesus, that word would probably be surrender. Surrender. Mary surrendered herself completely to God's will. And if we're going to follow Jesus, we've got to learn what it means to surrender ourselves to Him. Matthew 16:24, Jesus says, "If any of you wants to be my follower, you must turn from your selfish ways, take up your cross, and follow me." Jesus surrendered himself completely for you and me on that cross. He surrendered himself on the cross so that each of us could have our sins forgiven, so that the relationship between us and God that has been broken could be restored, so that we could have a home in heaven, so that we could be the people that God originally created us to be, and to live the life that we were born to live. Jesus tells us, if you're going to follow me, then it requires surrender. That you surrender your life, that you surrender your plans, that you surrender your agenda, and let Jesus lead your life. It's not enough to say, "Okay, God, I'm going to surrender a part of my life, but not this part of my life. Jesus, you can lead this part of my life, but I'm going to lead this part of my life. You can be the leader of this area, but you know what? I'm going to keep control of my career and my relationships and my finances. That's the part I'm not going to surrender." No. To follow Jesus means to surrender every area of your life. Let me ask you this question. What area of your life have you not surrendered to God? What area of your life have you not surrendered to God? Your relationships? Your marriage? Your sex life? Your career? Your finances? Are there areas of your life that you aren't surrendered to God in? Maybe there's an area of sin in your life. We all have those areas, right? An area that you know is not right, and you kept it carefully hidden from everyone else. But it's an area that you have not turned over to God. You haven't surrendered to Him. Maybe you need to surrender that area. Maybe it's something simple that God has asked you to do, but for whatever reason, you haven't done it. Maybe there's a relationship that God has for you to get out of, or that He wants you to get out of, but you haven't listened to Him. Perhaps you know that there's something that God wants you to do, but you're delaying obeying. You know you should be doing it, and you want to do it, but first you want to do this. Did you know that delayed obedience is disobedience? Whatever it is, will you surrender that to Him today? Romans chapter 6, verse 13 says, "Give yourselves completely to God, for you are dead, but now you have new life." Will you do that? Will you make Jesus Lord of your life? Will you give yourself completely to Him? Let's pray. Father, I pray for those that are here that are already Christians, that are followers of You. They say that they believe in You, but to be honest, God, like a lot of times in my life, I'm not always following You, and maybe they're not always following You. For those who have an area of their lives that they haven't surrendered to You, Jesus, help them see it. Maybe they already know that area of life that's full of worry and fear or shame, regret, or that's always stressing them out. Help them to surrender that to You as we pray, saying, "Jesus, in my heart and my mind, I'm on my knees, and I'm giving You this area of my life. I surrender it to You. I surrender my all to You." And Lord, I also pray for those who have never become a follower of Jesus. They've been living their life apart from you. Maybe today, for the first time, they sense your spirit calling them, and they're hearing that voice, and they want to surrender their entire life to you as we pray here. And we pray saying, Jesus, I believe in you. I know what you did on that cross. I believe it to be true. Jesus, today, for the first time, I don't want to be Lord of my own life. I need you. I need you to lead my life. Come into my life. Forgive me of my sins. Help me to live the life that you created me to live. I'm no longer going to be the leader of my life, but God, I want you to be the leader. Jesus, come into my life. And Father, we thank you for Mary. We thank you for her faithfulness to show us what it means to follow you. We thank you for your Son who surrendered everything on the cross so that we could have a real life. We love you, and we pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. this time together and follow Jesus in the way of the cross. Rejoice in hope, hold fast to what is good, persevere in prayer. Do not overcome evil by evil, but overcome evil with good. As far as possible, live peaceably with all. And may God hear your cries and deliver you. May Christ Jesus repay you with fullness of life. And may the Holy Spirit be with you always, nourishing you in love and hope. Amen and amen.
Draw near and bless your name.